And now, it's time for another Dice Tower review with the Game Boy Geek.
Hello, my friends, it's the Game Boy Geek here. Today, we are going to be fighting off zombies coming out of the ground. We're looking at Zombie 15. This is a real-time 15-minute game that comes with a soundtrack. It's cooperative. It's from 2 to 4 players, and it plays in exactly 15 minutes since it's timed. And it's a card-driven cooperative game. So let's take a look. I'll show you how it's played. I'll see you on the other side. Zombie 15 is a campaign-based real-time game. I mean, there's 15 different campaigns that you can do. This one is high security that we have set up. It's scenario number 5, and it's the last of the beginner series. The game takes exactly 15 minutes. It's a timed game, which there's a soundtrack CD that goes along with it. So let's show you how it's played. So this game takes up a ton of room on the table, but these big tiles here, essentially here is the start spot here. And essentially you're trying to get all your people alive and to the exit. There's a blue lock here. We're gonna be trying to find some blue keys. There's a red lock here. You're trying to find some red keys. But essentially that's what we're trying to do, is fight off the zombies and get to the end getting the right keys. At the beginning of the game, you get to pick one of the many characters that are in here. You know, we've got Hazel or Severity, Trevor, Will, Siphon, Snow, Josh. And each of these have special abilities. For example, he cannot fight barehanded, but he can heal 2 life points when he's in a first cave kit. It tells him what they start with, and he cannot be equipped with guns, but he can search or move when the zombies are there. So essentially gives you some ways to break the game for each person and tells you what you start with. Now the game comes with a ton of zombies. That is the boss, man. And then the other 3 pretty much look like that all the time, but there's tons of these zombies that you add to the game. So I have Vance here that I'm starting with. This is my player, and he starts with a machete and a small machete. So you have these icons that show that you can use it pretty much 1, 2, 3 times, each of these. And he has a health of 3 to start the game. So here's the start tile, and as you see, now there's tiles, and you see these yellow dotted lines. This is the normal city spot inside the space, and the dotted line is where you can search for things. So let's talk about what you can do on a turn. You have 4 actions until it's the next player's turn. So let's say I'm Vance. One of the things I can do is move. As long as there's no zombies in the same space as me, I can move. So if I move here for 1 action, I am now within 3 zombies, so I have to fight them because I can't just move away from them. And here's how we could fight. And remember, Vance can't use any guns, so he has a machete and a small machete. This tells me how many zombies it will kill with using it once. And so between the machete and the small machete, there's 3 zombies there. This is 3. I can swing this once and kill all those zombies. This tells me how much noise it makes. Since we're using a weapon like a machete, it doesn't make any noise. If we were, he can't, but if we were using a revolver, you could see this makes 1 noise. If you use a weapon that makes a noise, every time you use it, you add that many zombies to the horde box. The horde box starts with 3 every time it's emptied. And if we were to make noise, if that revolver was used and it made noise for one, we drop 1 there. We'll talk about how these zombies come out later. For my second action, because I used 1 to move, I used my second action to destroy all those zombies. For my third action, I can move into this search area. And for my fourth action, there's 2 types of searches I can do. Let's talk about the first one, which is like the normal search. Now this normal or quick search, you take the first 3 cards from the search deck and you look at them. If any of them are zombie cards, you add that many zombies to the search space that you're in. In this case, I would add 2. So boom, 2 zombies come to the search space right there. Now, I also had drawn a banjo and a grass trimmer. Let's say I wanted to keep the banjo. I could keep this. The rest of the cards go in a discard pile, and I get to put them in any order I want. And I'll put them like this, and I'll tell you why I did that. Now keep in mind, I can only have 1 weapon. This one can only be a green weapon. This one could be a green or a yellow weapon. And I kept the banjo. So let's say I had used this a bunch of times, where like in round 1, after a few turns, this has been used all the way. It wasn't gonna do me a whole lot of good anyways. I can get rid of this and use the weapon that I just got, which was the banjo, and power it up all the way to there. Now also, you can see this heavy object. Once in a while in some of the scenarios, you get these red heavy objects. It goes over both, and you can't use any of these other weapons because you're using this huge heavy object that's there. Sometimes you can carry some of your people as heavy objects, things like that. And so that would be my turn, and I would have been done with my 4, and I would say go next turn, and the next player would go. Now, the next player goes, first action, he goes here. Now, as you can hear the soundtrack behind me right now, there's two different soundtracks. There's one where there's a zombie growl every 60 seconds, another one where a zombie growls every 40 seconds. Depending on the scenario and the difficulty, you'll choose which soundtrack to use. Let's say, right now, as I just moved in here, we hear the zombie growl. We would flip over this zombie card here, ooh, and we would add 4 to the street space of the one that I am on. Wow, so 4 of them would come in right here in the street space of the one that I'm on. Even if it growled and I was in the search space at that point in time, let's say I was the green player and the growl came, it always goes to the street section. So now this player has to start fighting these zombies. However, if it growled again while I was on there and I flipped this up and it says horde, we would take the entire horde box of zombies and dump it onto that tile as well. Ooh, so this one is gonna get a ton of zombies to fight. Now let's say for the last couple actions, they got to take out a bunch of zombies and kill them. Also, once the horde box is empty, you always refill it with 3 to start the horde box. Now, if he ends his turn and there are zombies still in the area, you look at the highest weapon of any player that's in the same spot as him, and you look at how many each of those players can fend off. He can fend off 3 because his best weapon can be 3. Right now there's 3 zombies there, so he's safe. But if there was a 4th one there and he was the only one in this area, he would then fall down and take a damage. So he would go from 3 to 2. Once he gets to 0, he's unconscious and essentially he's laying down the whole time. And the only way you can win by at that point is having someone else carry him, being a heavy object, all the way to the finish line. But if these guys were both in the same area and there were 4 zombies, we have the 3 from Josh, and we have the best weapon here is 3 from Vance, that would be 6. And in that case, we could fend up to 6 zombies and nobody loses a life point. So it does pay to stay together. Now I've shown you most of the things you can do, but the last thing I want to show you is the careful search. Instead of doing the quick search, which is drawing 3 cards, you could draw something from here. Let's say if you wanted the katana, you could take this, but you have to discard out of the game everything above it. So if I want the katana, these would get discarded, and then I could get the katana and put it on myself. And that's what is known as a careful search. And of course, you can only do those when you're in the search areas. Again, that's pretty much how the game's played. You get 4 actions with 2 or 4 players. With 3 players, you each get 5 actions. With 2 players, each person controls 2 people. And essentially, you're moving. If you're with zombies, you're fighting zombies. If you're in the searches, you can do some searches. You're getting weapons, you're moving around, and you're trying to kill the zombies and get through it. In this specific scenario, to get through this lock, you gotta do some searching. You come here first and try to search here and hopefully find a key. Ooh, look at this, there's the keys. You would get these keys, and you could get through this gate. Without it, you can't. To get through this blue gate, same thing. There's a blue key somewhere. Oop, it's not there. And it's not there, and it's way over here is the blue key. So they're set up in possible spots to try to find where to go to get them, and every scenario is quite different. Some of these give you some backpack items that you can pick up in campaign mode. You can get these and get other items for future campaigns to use. But in general, that's pretty much how the game is played, and you win if all of you survive to get to the exit, otherwise you lose. Now, I'm not typically into zombie themes, but I really loved a game that was somewhat theoretically similar to this called Escape the Curse of the Temple. It's one of my favorite games ever. And that's a cooperative game where you're rolling dice and working together and with a timed thing. So I wanted to see how this differed and how it was the same, hoping that it could recapture that feeling of tenseness when you play it. So with this game, it definitely recaptures that tenseness. You know, you got the 15 minutes, you get the soundtrack going, you're going around. I mean, it's amazing that those growls on the CD are like 60 seconds apart, but it feels like they're every 5 seconds. It really does, where you're pouring them on and you go into search and you're trying to get some weapons and boom, more zombies show up. And it just feels like, oh man, I'm trying to get out of here. And it does feel really tense. So it does that aspect. First of all, I gotta say the production quality on this is absolutely amazing. I know it's a really expensive game, but it's a huge box. It's heavy. There's a ton of stuff in there. The artwork in this game is absolutely gorgeous. The miniatures, the zombie miniatures are really good, really nice. Pretty much every bit and piece of the components and the artwork of this game are stellar. Yellow knocked it out of the park with that. Now, as for the gameplay, for me, I wasn't as impressed with this as I was hoping to be. Now, granted, I do like that escape game where you're rolling the dice. What I felt with this game is I felt like even though it's a cooperative game, and I know a lot of people, some people don't like that alpha gamer, and this completely takes it out of the water, right? Because you're doing something on your turn, it's rushed, you're doing it really fast, you're trying to finish fast so the zombie growls on someone else's turn, not on yours. And it does work better when you stick together to kind of fend off those zombies at the end. The problem I had, or the reason why it didn't really sweep me off my feet, in fact, is I felt like on your turn, what you were supposed to do is quite obvious. It's like, oh, okay, I'm here, zombies are here, I gotta fight. Boom, boom, boom. Well, I gotta go over here and search. Go there and search. There weren't a whole lot of hard decisions to make, I think, during the time. Now, granted, I don't think it was supposed to be made that way because it's a quick game and you're supposed to be just working off the cuff. Now, you could argue and say that escape doesn't make you really think either, and it's pretty obvious what you're gonna do. And I'd say, yeah, you're probably correct, but I still love that game because even though you have a plan and it's quite obvious what you're gonna do, you two go down there, get down there, us two go down here, what happens with the dice always changes what really happens in that game. And here, it's the cards, and sure, the cards could play a different part, similar to what the dice are, but for some reason here, it just felt like it was obvious what I was gonna do on my turn, it was obvious what someone else should do on their turn, and we're just being overwhelmed by the zombies. So for me, I don't know, it just, it fell a little flat for me. It's not something that I typically want to pull out and play very often because of that. But I love the aspect that they have all those different campaigns, the 15 campaigns. Another big gripe with this game is it takes a long time to set up a scenario. I mean, it takes longer than it does to play the game, honestly. To find the tiles, find the right side of the tile, put them in the order, put the zombies on, sort the decks, it takes at least 15 minutes to set up a scenario. Now, granted, when you set up a new scenario, you're probably not going to beat it the first time. So you can probably play two or three times, and maybe it's not that bad after that. But the setup is a bear in this game. You're not going to set one up, play a scenario, set another one up, play another scenario. It's just too much setup time. So that's a negative on it, too. But if you don't mind the setup time and you really want to play a scenario a few times, then this might be something you want. If you like the zombie theme, this is an obvious. Production's awesome. It just didn't leave me swept off my feet with the gameplay. I just felt like it was a little, it was just... The tenseness was there, but I didn't feel like the decision making was because you know you're only doing something once every certain amount of turns. So as opposed to whether in Escape, you're actually going the whole time. Maybe that was it. Maybe there wasn't really downtime because everyone was moving fast, but I don't know. It's just something about it that didn't really sweep me off my feet. So I'm gonna pass on this one, but given what I've said and what I've showed you, maybe this one's for you.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.